Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you.
I'm hungry, spark, but I ain't starving yet. Chain for the pain, cocktail for the set. Never said I was a gangster or thug, but I'm an animal. Peanut for the taste of the
fly. I don't know what we're going to talk about. I honestly don't.
That's fine.
Let's get a chat.
I'm down to talk about whatever.
Yeah. I'm going to try to get them for 30, but these usually go long.
Okay.
People in studio, so.
I'm a rambler, so I'll try.
Good. Good. That makes my job easier.
I'll try and ramble just enough.
The secret to doing 7 podcasts in one night is you get a bunch of other people that will talk.
Did you do 7 to 7 tonight?
This is my
6th.
This is my 5th. Wait. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is my 5th, and I'm going to do 3 tiny ones.
Nice.
Before I go to bed.
Micro episodes.
Yeah. Well, it's like 10 minutes each.
Now, are they all video?
Yeah. I mean, everything goes out video, audio.
Yeah.
You know?
Nice.
All right. 91. Hey, guys. It's the Indy Mayhem Show. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter here in Pittsburgh, PA, at the Mayhem Studios. Video producer with some work with the IWC and the RWA. Those are just letters to anybody else. International Wrestling Cartel, Renegade Wrestling Alliance, and some other work, including the Montreal Theory, finding Zach Gowen. Stuff like that with Sorgatron Media. And we're ready to talk some pro wrestling, some independent pro wrestling with my good buddy. He is the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling of Austin, Texas, coming to us from San Antonio. Let's talk about the customer service person from San Antonio today, Eamon. I did not ask if they knew who you were.
Did you? I was going to say that'd be interesting. I'm happy to be here, as always, Sorg. I'm very excited to talk about all things independent wrestling, as always.
Excellent. We have a fun one here. We've got somebody in studio, and we'll introduce them in just a moment. But first, please check out everything and subscribe to this and all the other shows at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. And we're on social media. You can converse with us. Let us know what you thought about our interviews, indie wrestling that we're missing, and so much more. And, of course, check out the Around the Indies article over at IndieWrestling.us, where this show is also posting from our good friend in the mainstream media, Matt Carlins. And we'll touch on that a lot of times at the end of the show just to see what's going on, because he's really good keeping his ear to ground what is happening in independent pro wrestling. You can also drop us a line more directly. Let us know, who should we be talking to? We're looking at some people that were suggested to us more recently as well. You can drop us a line at 412-206-WMS0. That is going to be the voicemail, and we can get your voice here on the show, or good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. And please, if you're digging the wrestling stuff in general, you can check out our Patreon over at patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow. You're actually going to be donating to the main show if you're interested in that. But if anything else, if you don't want to donate any money to the cause, that's okay. Please just share the word, share interviews that you're digging, everything else. And we really, really appreciate it. So let's get into this. Oh, hey, also big props to Basic Sickness at BasicSickness.com for the intro and outro music for this and the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Get some free music over there at BasicSickness.com. So we got somebody in studio, Eamon, somebody local here. That's why he's in studio. That's why, Eamon, we need to get you a studio set up so everybody can just join you and hang out and, you know.
I think we mentioned that last week. Yeah, we got to figure out some sort of Texas headquarters, the Mayhem community branching out, I guess.
That's
you could
right.
Say.
We're going to open a Sorgatron Media West, or I guess so, a Sorgatron Media Central, because West will be when we finally get Alex Cars to put together a studio for us out there, and you can get some PWG guys. It'll be great, right? So
that'll work.
No big plans here, but we got in studio a guy that I've known for a couple years now with the IWC in particular. Remy Lavey joins us in studio. How you doing tonight, sir?
Sorg, thank you very much for having me. I've watched many of these in the past, and I was waiting for when I would get the invite.
Waiting for the call.
You've
been on my list of guy I need to get on for about a year.
I remember the first time I brought it up to you, and I kind of put it out there like, hey, Sorg, like, trying to have me on. But no, I mean, coming here and seeing it is very quite impressive setup. The people watching can only see the microphones. But I'm surrounded by various computers and screens and That's the way it should be. I love it.
That's it. That's it. So, you know, first of all, Remy Lavey, you're into wrestling. You're obviously that you've gone this far. We like to kind of get to know you a little bit first. What first got you into pro wrestling? What's your earliest kind of big memory of pro wrestling?
I'd say watching with my dad growing up. I remember probably first. I mean, I can't tell you the actual first time. I literally have no idea. I was very, very young. But my first actual kind of like real memories probably would come around 95, 96, 97 maybe. Right before the Monday Night Wars and whatnot. I'm 26 now. So I was, I believe, the perfect age for that time. And I just remember it was something that my dad encouraged, and I don't think my mom really liked it that much. But my dad saw that I took liking to it early on, and he was very supportive and very influential in terms of music and just being a little kid. And he was always kind of putting stuff in front of my face, and he'd pay attention to what really caught my attention. And then he'd kind of, he took me to Mellon Arena, a bunch of times to see wrestling growing up. And I remember just being so caught up in the characters. And growing up, I was always really into pretty much anything that had a lot of characters, and that's variation. And I think it's important, and I think that's one of the things I still love about wrestling is I have a lot of different weird sides of my personality, and I've always really liked connecting with the different wrestlers growing up, you know. And of course, when the Attitude Era came, being 12 year old kid, and all of a sudden I felt like I was watching something that I wasn't supposed to be watching. And I distinctly remember dialing in ECW in kind of like our side TV room one night, and TV was a really big thing. I remember South Park wrestlers. I was really into like South Park wrestlers, and AOL was, the internet was kind of just, I remember just completely taking over our family's computer, and everything was wrestling websites, wrestling art, wrestling, South Park wrestlers, all that kind of early AOL chat room type stuff, which is really crazy to think about now. But I remember that kind of, it was a time where I found myself watching TV a lot more often. I'd come home from school and I would watch TV and hang out and draw, or I would hang out and play with toys, and there was always something on in the background, whether it was a movie or wrestling. And I think I just found it struck something in me that was very inspiring and larger than life, but also something that was very real. It was, I think the first time we went, I remember standing outside of the igloo. And there was kind of that side entrance that went down and into the side where all the wrestlers would park and come out. And I remember, I think it kind of clicked for me the first house show I went to, which had to have been, I want to say, maybe 98 or 99. And I just remember once I saw that they were right there in front of me, it kind of all clicked that this is something larger than life, but also very real at the same time. These are real people. And I was still very innocent and naive to the whole thing, and to an extent. And my dad was always kind of making sure I knew that it was, you know, a work, if you will.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I at that point, I'd tune my dad out, and I would take in whatever I wanted to take in. And just very attracted to the overall diversity within it. And something that was so violent could also be so creative. And I liked that it was constant and always changing, and that and at that time, being a wrestling fan was great because you had so much to choose from. Wrestling magazines were a big thing for me. And like I said, just AOL and the whole internet kind of becoming a thing. That was crazy.
That's something we haven't really had this. I guess we kind of sort of have this discussion with Eamon here because he was kind of a younger guy coming up around the same era. I guess a little later, actually, Eamon, right? And
yeah, definitely a little bit later.
One thing I don't realize is I'm somebody who, around 11 years old, it was still real.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh yeah.
And you know, to like, it was like somebody telling me Santa Claus wasn't real. Sorry, McFoley. that was the thing. I was the weird, and also insular. You talk about the AOL chat rooms, and you think about in the 80s, it was like it was you.
Yeah,
you
know, there was no nothing.
And it wasn't cool to be a wrestling fan so much in high school.
No, and
or in elementary school, even, I guess.
And I feel like I really wore that on my sleeve. I feel like I kind of even picked up on that at a young age, and mm-hmm. I've always been really proud of the stuff that I'm really into, and I would almost kind of. You know, and I went to a small private school called Winchester Thurston, and it was it was a great school, but I definitely felt like the only one. I remember just specifically forcing my other friends to trying to force wrestling on them, and I was literally the only person until about sixth grade when I met my best friend Kevin, and we were best friends because of wrestling. But until leading up until that, I remember it being something that was kind of my own, and I felt like I was this young kid kind of like representing wrestling, and I knew why it was cool to me, and I had no problem throwing that in other people's face or other kids' face. I thought I was the man in my DX shirt.
That's awesome. So what parlayed, you know, obviously it's several years before you get into the ring here. Between that era and then, at what point did you determine I'm going to do this, I'm going to get into the ring?
I had always watched wrestling in high school, but I also consider that the era that I was becoming a freshman in high school. I was about to go to high school, and a lot of things in my life were changing. I was really getting into music and going to shows, and that was when I kind of really was focused on music and wanting to do a band and wanting to learn how to play guitar. And wrestling at that point had become, I felt like my interests had gone away from wrestling, but there was all this new stuff all of a sudden in front of me. And I always had paid attention to wrestling, and especially like I remember seeing Christopher Daniels and Punk throughout high school, and that was kind of, I was never huge into the Indies throughout high school. It was definitely very foreign to me, but I was aware of it. I knew what it was. I knew who these guys were. But that was like the era of also like middle school was like media play. So there was a lot of like XPW, and there was a lot of companies, and there wasn't so, you know, YouTube really wasn't a thing. And if there were Indies out there, there wasn't really, I certainly wasn't smart at all whatsoever. During this time, I kind of had always kept up with wrestling, but I wasn't watching it weekly, and I had really focused into music. And it wasn't actually until about, I'd say, 5 or 6 years ago where I met one of my closest friends, Tyler, who I had known from going to shows and through the local hardcore scene here in Pittsburgh. And it was like the one thing that the two things that we were both really into were music and wrestling. And we had never talked about wrestling. And as soon as we talked about wrestling, we both were just on that same page where we kind of had this nerdy, you know, can't ditch this knowledge if I tried. And me and him became really, really good friends. And I was actually going through like a weird time. And, he kind of was the one that brought me up to speed. Like, this is what you've been missing. Like, this is what's going on. Cause he had, you know, he's been a lifer. He's never stopped. And he is like the mastermind of wrestling. He actually tried out with me. And so we started going to IWC. We started going to CZW. We started traveling, and everything was wrestling again. And I started watching wrestling. I started watching the independents, and I was kind of fell back in love with it. Being older, I started to watch it differently than I watched it when I was younger. And now I was realizing, I felt like in high school, I felt like I had kind of seen everything and played every game and been to every website that I could have. And I kind of let my high school years go by. And before I knew it, he was bringing me up to speed and introducing me to all this new stuff, which got me back interested again, because it was new to me and there were these new guys and the independence was a thing and whoa, what is this? Who are these guys? And this is a thing. And like I had been playing music independently for so long. So independent wrestling is so similar. That's something I always say. And me and him started going to IWC and we made some friends up at CZW. And we're going out there a couple times to just hang out and a couple conversations and a little bit of research. Yeah, there you go.
There you go. Miscue. Sorry about that.
No, it's all
good. But yeah, this is actually the Dojo Wars stuff that they're doing up there.
Yes, that is the Big Scare Dan O'Hare. And this was something I kind of just did on a whim.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of decided to... It's funny. Usually this place is packed. When me and Darren went up there a month or two ago, there was actually some people, you know, filled out. But this was the weekend of the World of Worlds, the New Japan ROH shows. So I literally got done here and got to catch the end of that show, which was an awesome weekend of shows. And this is Dan O'Hare, who is awesome, who's also a musician. And I remember being very nervous. I hit up Drew Gulak, who was one of the guys from CZW when I was going to Philly with my friend Tyler. He was someone that stood out to me. And guys like Adam Cole and Rich Swan and Uha and all these up-and-coming guys from CZW who have since gone on and most of them done incredible things, as I knew they would, but... You know, they were a big influence on me, and they knew that I kind of was a music guy, but they also saw my desire to get involved, and this trip was very special to me. It represented the match is whatever, you know, but it represented a 360, a somewhat, you know, I don't believe wrestling kind of ever ends, as I'm learning, but it was a nice... Mm-hmm. kind of revelation to have as I was having this match that I'd taken so much influence and I have so much respect for CZW and a lot of my friends who I've watched, you know, perform in Philadelphia. And my sister was there and my friend Tyler got to come and see me there, and everyone there from DJ to Drew to Joey Janela to Jonathan Gresham. I mean, and these are guys that I'm still a mark for and guys that I still hold, you know, to a certain standard. So to me, it was just super cool. But IWC was obviously the place in Pittsburgh, in my little area here. And I started going to the shows, and I knew that if I was going to train, that was the place to do it. And I honestly didn't think I was going to even pass the tryout. It was kind of like, try it out. Hey, let's see if you last, kind of thing. And
at least to say you did it, right?
Yeah, it's pretty crazy, man. I think there was six other people, and I'm the only one left here at IWC. Out of my class. So, and I think that if you would have seen the class lined up, I don't think people would have thought that. Maybe they would have.
It's really interesting to see who's going to drop out and the reasons that they do. I mean, you know, we talk about like the Performance Center tryouts that was, I think, late last year. I know Asylum was part of that class up there. And seeing the true athletes that go in and say, oh, I didn't know it was like this.
Right,
you know,
right.
And they're people that were, you know, champions in whatever sport they were. You know, they're not strangers to working hard, you know.
Right.
But even I know there was somebody with the IWC class I was talking with somebody with a few weeks ago. Like, they went through the class and got to their first match, and then they're like, nope.
Yep.
Nope, not
and
for me.
I just don't understand how you can... You have to really love this to do it.
Exactly.
It sounds so repetitive and it sounds so, you know, whatever, but it's the truth, man. I mean, it boggles my mind sometimes when I run into someone and they don't have that passion, that knowledge. And I'm not an elitist in any way, but it's just, I just can't understand what would make a sane person want to do this if they weren't absolutely in love with it. And it's, you know, it's crazy to me. You really have to love this. You really have to strive. You really have to find something inside yourself that, that believes that you can do this. And self-confidence is a huge thing. When I did that tryout and Chuck called me, he told me it wasn't going to be easy. He told me straight up that I was going to have to bust my ass. And I was ready for it. I knew exactly what I was getting myself in for. And I didn't want anything handed to me. It had been such a long time since I felt I had challenged myself or pursued something that was brand new to me and kind of separate from my group of friends and my social circle. And every single step of it, every drive alone, because I'm kind of a loner, and I've found that being a loner in wrestling is, it's good. It's a kind of a double-edged sword, but it has its positives and its more depressing sides. But you know, I really wouldn't have it any other way, because it is my experience, and the journey. You know, it's literally changing your life completely, and you have to be ready to adapt. You have to be ready to balance wrestling and everything else, because wrestling becomes a world of its own, and everything else is still there. And around the time that I was training, a lot was going on. My mom moved away, my sister moved away. Things with my band and stuff were slowing down, and I remember just thinking to myself that I had to make sure that my life and my schedule was going to be able to accommodate the ridiculous schedule of professional wrestling. I don't even remember this match.
It's System Elite versus Gory and
Yuta. Oh yes. Yeah. Facade couldn't make it, so they threw me in here.
Oh, okay.
This was probably one of my fourth or fifth matches. Look at my long hair. I miss my long hair. But yeah, I mean, to make kind of like a longer story short, I essentially just reconnected with it, and there was a calling, and there was a new, I had fallen in love with it again, and I had found new things about it that was connecting with me. It kind of pulled me out of the slump. It was something to escape into. And I think I was actually just talking to Joe Dombrowski last night about the aspect of escaping. And I believe that is the true when I'm watching as a fan or when I'm performing. It's always an escape. It's always everything that isn't work. It's always everything that isn't, you know, bills to pay. It's always everything that isn't, you know, running around trying to hang out with a bunch of friends and keep everyone happy. It's, you know, it's very specific, and it's very kind of isolates you into the moment and into the process and schedule of being a wrestler. And it kind of forces you to either roll with it or get left behind, because wrestling is not going to stop. And there's a ton of other guys all fighting for table scraps. And, you know, it was a really crazy thing. I didn't think I would pass, but I'm glad I finished, and I'm glad I've stuck with it. And it's truly been a dream. It's I'm living out a dream. I always think about, you know, 12-year-old me looking at me now would think I was pretty cool. So that's kind of how I've looked at it, and that's kind of, you know, why I decided to pursue it. Was, to me, it is the one of the few things that has been able to keep me in touch with my innocence and in touch with my inner, you know, 12-10-year-old me, which is something that I feel is taken from me every day as I get older. And wrestling has always been that bridge of the gap. And now more than ever, I find it really being important in my life.
Don't mind. So you've done a lot of evolution over the years. I know with IWC, you were big, you know, in a tag team, and you guys were really coming together. And now I think you're kind of, I think we talked about, in kind of a position of kind of, I don't know, I don't want to say reformatting yourself, but you know, kind of giving yourself a new version, right?
Right.
So, I mean, how are you finding that process kind of more generally? And what have you learned about evolving, like, who Remy Lavey is over the past several years?
I think that to be someone like me and the kind of wrestler and the kind of person that I can kind of take a step outside myself, I think that it's very important. It's important to have an ego, but it's also important to be realistic,
mm-hmm.
you know? And you have to understand that this is a business, whether it's independence, whether it's Ring of Honor, whether it's WWE, whether it's NXT, it is the wrestling business. It's not wrestling club for fun. Some places are like that, and that exists.
And some people, that's all they're out there to do, right?
Right, and that is totally fine. That is absolutely fine.
Mm-hmm.
But me, like I said, it kind of goes back to when I decided to train. I got into this knowing exactly what I was getting myself into, or at least I thought I did, and now I have. Some of those things were dead on, and some of them were wrong. But I knew, I understood that it was a business, and that you were working for someone, and that you were taking someone's ideas and influence and making it your own. And I believe that you have to be extremely patient. I've been extremely patient, and you have to be. And like I said, I didn't expect anything to be handed at me, to me, I should say. I didn't expect anything to be just handed over to me in terms of anything with IWC or any other company. I've wanted to work for it, and I wanted to earn it. And it you know, I feel like if it's given to you, it's kind of, I don't know, it kind of depreciates it and devalues it.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to test myself to see if this is something I could really do. I wasn't going to lie to myself about this. And so I think that it's been a lot of patience. It's been a lot of twists and turns, a lot of things you have to accept are out of your control. You are responsible pretty much for yourself. You're your own manager. You're in charge of your merch. You're in charge of your own promotion. You're in charge of getting your name out there. You're in charge of making sure you get to the building. There are so many factors that go into it, and that specifically require you to kind of be aware of the business that you're in. And it's easy to get discouraged, and it's easy to feel confused, and it's easy to feel alone. It's easy to feel like, especially when you're someone like me, who I know what it takes. I know my high standards of in terms of being a fan my whole life, or a fan over the last few years, what I've noticed about wrestling, what makes a great wrestler, what makes a great match. All those things that I didn't look for when I was a kid, because I was just more enchanted, and I was just, you know, I was being a kid watching wrestling. As you get older, you start to appreciate the work rate, and great matches and great storytelling. And to me, my character has always been, when I started training, I always saw the character, and I had some cool ideas. I've had some ridiculous ideas, and I remember trying all this ridiculous stuff. But you also have to remember that you are appealing to a specific crowd. You're appealing to a wrestling crowd, and no matter how many cool, weird pulp culture references I want to make, or take my weird influences and put it out there, it's important to remember that it has to be processed by the audience, and that the crowd has to understand. That's probably been the hardest part for me, is trying to find a way to do my own thing and not make the crowd feel excluded.
That's right. I remember even early conversations you and I have had about your character and what you wanted to do with it. And I always felt like, I don't want to say that they were complicated, but again, like, that kind of, like, where's
it's kind of schizophrenic.
Yeah. Like, where's that connection going to happen? Right. Like, I like the idea and concept. I understand it. But again, like you said, like, how is the guy that just bought a ticket to their first show going to understand, you know, how do you convey that in 2 seconds? You know, like,
right.
Like, we were joking around earlier. There was a match happening in their promotion where there's a caveman and a superhero. Like, okay, I get that.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's the most, like, that's probably the easiest thing to convey, right?
Right.
Or you know, Jock Sampson's the redneck. You know, all right, we know what we're getting here. You know, what do you, and I'm seeing you try, you know, and I'm seeing where that's going. And it's been interesting to watch that evolution.
I think that for me, it's actually something I've been thinking about a lot. And I feel like that question, you know, summarize yourself in one sentence, or someone goes home and calls their friend, what are they going to say they remembered about you? How are they going to be able to describe you? How can you describe that? And there is a really big part of me that believes that revolutionary might be a bit of extreme, maybe a bit extreme, but I believe I would like to get my character to the point where I'm not an answer. It is a question. I think my character should be a question. I think I've always liked wrestling. I believe that, like I said, that the audience needs to process it. But I also believe that one of the best things about wrestling, and one of my favorite things about wrestling, has always been the things that have kind of been left to your imagination, the subtleties.
Okay.
And that's what I've liked about music and lyrics and movies. David Lynch is probably my favorite director, and he's someone who artistically never really gives away a base narrative or a plot. It's kind of here it is, and you can come to your own conclusions about what this means.
Have you seen any samples of this in wrestling? Like, we could give some sample to try to.
In terms of subtleties, I would say there. I mean, it's kind of separate, but I remember when Sting stopped talking, and that was insanely impactful on me.
Oh, probably the most interesting and intriguing storyline they ever did in WCW, to be honest.
And being that age, and his look attracted me. I was always into dark stuff growing up. I was always attracted to the balance of beauty and darkness, and, you know, that yin and yang. It's something I've always been interested in. It's always I can't really just put my finger on why I'm kind of wired that way. But Sting was a character who didn't talk. He looked like a bad guy, kind of. And the story of why he became Sting and what he was before that was so great. He was someone that you would never expect to kind of... It was someone that I watched, you know, when he was blonde Sting. He was all babyface, fired up, super energetic. It was someone... And then when he became the Crow Sting, it was like someone had kind of come to my side, or someone was kind of appealing to the kids like me, the darker kids. But it was someone who you would have never expected to kind of go that course, and to kind of someone that you would never feel like you could relate to in that level, or feel that special connection with. And I think that was just done really well, and it was patient, and nothing was, it wasn't forced. And everything that Sting did was kind of like a question. It was kind of like very mysterious, mind games. There was the fake Sting, you know, there was the fake Sting coming from the rafters. He was posing a lot of questions. Why is he in the rafters? Why does he have a vulture? Why is there a fake Sting? Is he good? Is he bad? Why isn't he talking? And to me, those were all questions. And I believe that you need to have someone to play off of to kind of give some answers. But I essentially would like to continue my character on a path of mystique, and I think mystique is very intriguing, and I believe that's what I feel, that's the character that I want to bring to life. And while it is equally frustrating, just as frustrating, you know, trying to figure this out, I wouldn't have it any other way, because it's not something you rush, and it's not something that I would want to rush or force. So it's been, you know, instead of just saying, putting a stamp on it and saying, this is what I am, I'd rather let the crowd and time kind of determine the different little facets of my character and personality. And at the same time, artistically provoke the audience into asking questions. Interesting. Answers aren't as important to me.
Interesting to see how this comes across as you're
it could completely fail, and I could be a complete retard. I'm sure there's people out there shaking their heads, but I mean, I'm a different person. I believe I'm a different wrestling fan. I believe I'm a different wrestler, and I'm going to do things the way I want to do them. I'm very compromising in this business, is you have to, and you know, there are times when you have to compromise, and you're working with someone else's ideas. But I believe in there lies the challenge, and in there lies the fun of trying to make it your own. And how would Remy, you know, react to this, as opposed to how would, you know, just any wrestler react to this? Because it's easy to fall into, especially when you're young like me and you're green and mm-hmm. you're trying to figure everything out. It's easy to kind of fall into generic heel, generic baby face. And that never, I was never, work in terms of character, I was never interested in that. In terms of selling and in ring, I knew that you can go back and watch all my first year matches. I was pretty much just selling the entire time. So I believe that it's important to know your role and know your role as the character, and that there are two sides. And I believe babyface and heel is insanely important, and is insanely important in telling that story.
Right.
But I think that the lines between what is right and what is wrong need to be there in terms of wrestling. That's why we have rules, and that's why we have, you know, we as wrestling fans, there are certain things that we have morals, and certain things, there's integrity in certain things. And we respond when certain things happen to the certain people that we feel a certain way about. And it's important to, I think, keep it fresh, keep it interesting, keep it cool, and keep it new, and give someone something different. And that's what I want to offer, is just something different. And I think everyone's going for that, but I think that I'm kind of in a niche of characters on my own in terms of dark characters, and what's been done with kind of the darker characters. And you have Bray Wyatt and the more occult type stuff going on. And finding my own niche, you know, has been hard, because every time I have an idea or something, it feels like, you know, someone else scoops it up, or someone else does something similar. I see someone doing something similar, and I'm like, oh, all right, I can't do that now. Mm-hmm. But it's very interesting. The character development is a puzzle. You're constantly putting together your character and adding things to it, and maybe taking things away. And it's a learning experience. You got to see what the crowd responds to. But it's also been, you know, it's frustrating. It's hard. It shouldn't be easy. But a lot of it has been just trial and error, and believing in myself, and believing in these ideas, and taking risks. It's just a matter of having the opportunity to get those things across, and having people be willing to be open-minded when it comes to professional wrestling.
Awesome. So what are you watching these days? What's kind of got your attention?
I'm not gonna lie, NXT, I've kind of dropped off watching NXT. I didn't get to see the last TakeOver show with Balor and Joe, but I really wanted to watch it. I really love NXT. I think it is an amazing show. It's very special. It's its own thing. It's very cool. And I like the characters down there. And that's kind of where I'm coming to realize, is that character, how important character is, and the distinct things that, you know, make up a character, and how that character comes across on TV, the things they can do when you're on TV weekly, as opposed to locally in front of a crowd. Watching NXT for me has been great for watching the in-ring product, watching the promos. If you're a wrestler, you don't want a young wrestler on the independents, and you aren't watching NXT, it's very confusing to me. Mm-hmm. Because that is the kind of where we're all trying to get to right now. New Japan, I've loved New Japan. My roommate Tyler has the New Japan World. So whenever we hang out, we usually stream some New Japan. We always watch the Wrestle Kingdom shows, stay up super late. Guys like Ishii, guys like Shibata, guys like Michael Elgin just had a great showing over there. I was really happy to see Mike go over there and kind of reignite, if you will. I feel like he really killed it over there and showed that he still was a top tier player for sure. Because there was that weird stuff that happened with him with ROH when he had the belt, and just kind of like, oh, I felt bad for him. I felt like he was kind of, everyone kind of turned their back on him because he said he wanted to try playing baseball or something like that. So New Japan is, I'm always watching New Japan. I really, really like New Japan. I really like the seriousness. I really like the almost less is more approach to New Japan. And the in-ring product kind of speaks for itself. And it's just super epic and super taken seriously. Like, you should take it seriously. Like, it should be taken seriously. I feel like if I'm hanging out with a girl and I want to show her wrestling and I want her to think what I do is cool, I'm going to show her New Japan wrestling because of how seriously it's taken over there. And there's an aesthetic and there's a vibe that New Japan has completely outside of the in-ring product. Everything that's kind of surrounding it, you see it and you're like, is this professional wrestling or what am I watching? This looks like professional wrestling. They're doing professional wrestling moves. They're wearing professional wrestling gear, but something about it is just on another level. And the Bullet Club stuff's awesome. I love Kenny Omega. I love a lot of guys that have gone over there who are great wrestlers, and you get to see that now. Guys like, Killer Elite Squad, Lance Hoyt, and D.A. Smith. David Boy's kid, right? That's his partner?
Yeah.
And A.J., I actually got to do the AJ Styles seminar in Meadville. I think This was whenever he wrestled. Was it him and Saw? Who did he wrestle last
him
year?
Him and Nice?
Him and Nice. Yes, it was him and Nice. Which was a great match.
I'm so sad that people left before that because it wasn't the big, big name.
It was the best match of the night.
It was.
Easily.
Maybe about the year.
And I remember Styles. It was right when Styles was getting ready to go over to New Japan.
Right.
And he was just the coolest guy. AJ Styles, coolest guy I've met in wrestling yet. Nicest guy. And he was going over to New Japan. It was right before he was going over to join Bullet Club. And he was just telling us about how nervous he was and just so down to earth. Wow. And so chill and just very humble, insanely humble. Mm-hmm. And it was like, damn, like that's the kind of wrestler I can only hope to turn into. And especially in terms of being humble for all he's done. He doesn't have to be like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think he's awesome. He's done another guy that's kind of done things his way, but proven that he is one of the best. And he's been one of the best for a long time. So I really like New Japan. I really like the characters and I like how there's storylines, but it's not a lot of hokey stuff. It's more in-ring promo and you don't need to understand what they're saying to feel it, and they're so good at that. And I just like how aware the roster is and kind of how nicely packaged everything is. It's a very nice, neat, tight, clean package, and I really like that. And it's focused in the ring. PWG, always watching PWG. I think the last thing I saw was Tremendous, or was it? I don't think the battle. I think we just got the battle lost. It was whichever one was had like Aerostar. It had some the last show that had the Lucha Underground guys and Helico and Jack Evans were teaming.
Right.
And PWG is just great. You got guys like Trevor Lee. You got the Bucks over there. You got Super Dragon and Roderick Strong, who has probably been the best wrestler in the country for the last year and a half, in my opinion. And I wouldn't say he's underrated, but he's certainly underrated in terms of kind of where he's at. I think he could be. I don't understand why WWE hasn't picked up Roderick Strong yet.
Awesome.
And I like watching all the local stuff. I watch PWX when I can. I watch all our IWC shows. I try and pay attention to all the local stuff going on as much as I can. I would really like to get into UK wrestling a lot more because I feel like UK wrestling is very young and kind of hip and cool. And you see a lot of the UK independents doing so well on social media. And I follow quite a lot of UK companies, European companies, and Germany, and that's always appealed to me too. Is I try and watch as much stuff as that as you can, but as you know, Sorg, watching wrestling is like a full time job now.
It almost is, yeah. Not enough opportunity with it either. So,
I think it's good to have that some variety though. I mean, there's so much out there now. Mm-hmm. There's something mm-hmm. for everyone.
You can't say, oh, wrestling sucks. It's like, well, there's something, right? You got to find something. You know, try some of this. And especially, it's great that it's getting on TV. Different varieties like Lucha over here and Ring of Honor over here even is something different, you know.
So. Right. And I think we're starting to see, I think with Punk, you know, Punk was a big deal. I think Punk brought a lot of people back into it
mm-hmm.
and a lot of young people and maybe people who had fallen out of wrestling after the Attitude Era or the, you know, fallen out in the mid 2000s, kind of like I did. And Punk kind of brought those people back and threw some spice into it. But I mean, I love watching all of it. I just really love when there's good competition amongst the, you know, when everyone's motivated and firing on all cylinders. It's hard to turn on any wrestling these days and for me to find something that I don't like. There's always something for me to enjoy. And, you know, I think that's also something I'm very lucky about is that I'm able to kind of just enjoy when I want to enjoy and focus when I want to focus. And it's still that escape for all types of reasons. It serves all my mental needs.
Excellent. Well, you got a lot of stuff coming up here. Of course, IWC's Unbreakable is this weekend.
Yes. Big match Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
Love Keith. Keith Hott. I love working with Keith. I love talking to Keith. I love seeing Keith and giving him a hug every time I see him in the locker room. One of the hardest working wrestlers in this area. One of the nicest, biggest hearted wrestlers I've ever met. And Keith is truly the man. And working with him is always fun. Hentai and Bubba. Bubba is... I remember Bubba being around when I first started coming to IWC shows
mm-hmm.
and just being from Pittsburgh, you know Bubba. And that's kind of cool. I haven't really gotten to talk to him very much, but he's always been super nice to me. And Hentai, I had trained under Hentai a little bit and also one of the nicest, hardest working guys from this area who has been around the block and then some and is still kicking ass, still going hard. And I'm really excited for what me and Joe can do. I'm really excited for the match. I'm really excited for the challenge. Elizabeth is always a great crowd. Like, that's the building that I kind of view as, like, okay, this is IWC building. This is where it counts mm-hmm. the most. And this is where I want to do my best and really have a great match. So I think everything is there for that to happen. All the ingredients are in place. So I'm very much looking forward to this weekend. I have been sick, so if I sound a little nasally to everyone, I'm sorry. All this sick rambling.
Just in time for all this audio, right?
Right. It always works out like that. And I have a low voice anyway. I must sound
awesome. Go check it out. IWCWrestling.com to get tickets. A lot of stuff coming out, including the NXT's Rhino. I guess it's weird to saying that. The current champ.
It's awesome. Another super, super cool guy and
mm-hmm.
really helpful. And when these guys come to your cities, you know, and represent, it's I think people need to realize how, you know, these guys don't have to do that.
No.
These guys, if you see someone doing something like this, it is because they truly love it and they truly want to be there and they truly want to be there to entertain you. And it says a lot about Rhino and it says a lot about all the talent that comes through IWC. And one of the best things is you're not only getting, you know, great in-ring, you're also getting great personality. You're getting legends. You're getting young guys. You're getting the indie guys. You're getting a little bit of everything. There's something for everyone, specifically at IWC.
It is interesting looking in the past maybe five so years of WWE or even any of the rest of the big promotions on television and seeing how many people have a pedigree with IWC.
That's I always think about that. I remember watching like an old interview of Chris Hero and he has an IWC shirt on and it's just awesome. Like
or anytime they mention Pittsburgh in general yep. on on
Cabana
WWE
and
Network.
Punk and yeah.
Well, there was the Corey Graves talking about, oh, Pittsburgh, we did this, but 9.5 out of 10, except for when he's talking with Seth Rollins, he's talking about IWC.
And I always thought that was cool when they did the Punk documentary, and I think even on the big Punk podcast, the Cabana podcast that Punk was on, when he kind of came out and told his story, he was like, you know, wrestling was fun when it was you and me and Prazak driving to Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm, and you know, people always talk about Norm, and you know, it's good. It's a good thing to train.
Norm Connor's got name dropped on TV.
I know,
that CM Punk ECW guys thing back in the day. So
and you know, that just shows the impact that Norm had and that IWC had.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's just like anything, man. It's just like music. It's like times change, and the format may, you know, change a little bit, but essentially, you know, it's not easy to keep something alive, something that's kind of underground. Mm-hmm. And that's what always has attracted me to independent wrestling since I started getting into it. I like underground music. I like independent music. I tend to, I don't know, flock towards that kind of stuff. And it seemed like independent wrestling was the perfect type of wrestling for me. And I really like the travel, and I really like the grind, and the you know, the making towns. I love that stuff, and being kind of in charge of yourself. And it's also, it's just, it's helped me be a better me in a way, you know. It's helped me kind of apply some of that focus and hard work into other little things in my life that, you know, I'm discovering every day. And you never, you always hear everyone say, and it's very true, you never stop learning. And learning, constantly learning, is, and having different opinions and talking and meeting different people, all the awesome people you get to meet and interact with. Always the one thing in common is that you love wrestling. If you have nothing else in common with them, you both love wrestling. Yeah, I mean, the fact that I'm sitting down here talking to you about wrestling is awesome. Like, I do this. This is the kind of stuff I would like to do more of. And it's crazy to be on such a busy schedule, but this is the kind of stuff, the underground, the DIY, the passion, the passion projects are always, you know, what I've been attracted to and what I've tried to keep myself busy with. So wrestling to me is also a passion project, and it's also a dream, and it's a lot of things. It can be whatever you want it to be. And I really like that. I think that is insanely diverse, and for someone's personality like mine, it's great, because I'm all over the place with different creative needs and outlets and whatnot.
Awesome. Go check him out, IWCWrestling.com. His Twitter is at Remy Lavey, and you're on the Facebook as well, right?
Yeah, Remy Lavey or Wyatt Shear on Facebook. Either is fine. I just want to say thank you to Sorg. Sorg, for those of you who don't know, busts his ass every show to make sure that we have a professional high-end product. And it's important to acknowledge every job of an independent company, of the wrestling company. You know, it, like I said, it's really a team effort, and there's a camaraderie there and a kind of teamwork mentality that I never really had in sports or anything. I never played sports or anything. So it's cool to be, feel a part of something. And Sorg is just as important as anyone in that locker room or anyone on that show.
Yeah,
if not more, because I don't think any of us would be able to pull this off.
Thank you. I really do appreciate that. Go check them out. And we'll be talking about some more indie wrestling. But first, let's take a peek at last week in Sorgatron Media show.
That your dog?
Yeah.
Is it a tiny dog?
Yeah, it's a long-haired koala.
Bring it to me.
No. Why?
I want to put some in my mouth.
No.
Why does my PS4 keep downloading Barbie Horse Adventure?
What you're telling me is that PS4 has turned into TiVo.
Yeah.
Which means at some point, you're going to watch Super Redneck Trucker Yes. It's going to be like, oh, we downloaded every episode of Queer as Folk for you.
What is on Katie's face?
The Galaxy Gear VR, mm-hmm. which is made by Samsung in partnership with Oculus. There's going to be a consumer version that comes out. I think this is to get developers thinking on how they can build their apps and how things work.
Tell us, what is the concept? What is Looking for Group?
It's a mixed co-working and gaming space. Pay by the hour to play on Xbox Ones, PlayStation 4s, Wii U's, or PCs.
Aska? Is that how we're saying it?
WWE's doing one thing right, because Japanese pronunciation, you never pronounce the U. Okay, but it's Aska.
Aksan.
Asuka. Yeah, that's awesome. I can't wait until she knees Dana Brooke in the eye and gives her a little lecture or whatever.
Check out everything you just saw there at SorgatronMedia.com. So much more, some gaming, some technology in Hobo that did not eat my dog. I swear, it completely safe. You probably heard him barking in the last segment. Everything is cool. It's okay. Don't call PETA. But anyways, some more, of course, IWCWrestling.com. Check out this weekend's show. And, of course, that'll be available on IndieWrestling.us afterwards. But we also had a big show this past weekend, RWA's Bloody Harvest 2015. I got the sound guy and joins us usually from RWA Hot Wheels, RWA on the Twitters, joining us on the line. How you doing, Wheelz?
I'm doing pretty good there, Sorg. I mean, hey, it was a busy weekend and we got to watch all kinds of wrestling action.
Yes, we did. I mean, we did. It's been a good time for RWA as well. A good time for Pittsburgh wrestling in general. It seems like everybody's doing really interesting. A lot of stuff popping, no matter what three letters you got around you. But you guys had a really good show this week. I know we had fun from our perches that you mentioned in the last show. We moved a little bit, so we're not having wrestlers land in our lap.
We kind of moved up, if you will. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it honestly, it's a lot better for me, for you. Like you said, no wrestlers on our laps, no fans on our way. I enjoyed the show even more than I did when I was down where I was. I mean, I could see the action from bell to bell now. I mean, when you saw wrestlers going out of the ring and downstairs or chasing each other around an arena, you didn't miss it this time. You could see it all just watching them everywhere.
Right. Kind of speaking to that. Yeah. They kind of stuck us up on the stage as here's my shot of Wheelz right here, which is perched, which means somebody's got to pick them up and stick them up there. I thought you were kind of
very interesting.
I thought you were like kind of trapped as it was at these shows, but even more so. And those don't know, the wrestlers are right behind the curtain for us, and I can't get anywhere. I have to go through them in order to get anywhere from there. So the place is growing. You guys are packing the house. Four months straight of breaking your month to month records. For attendance, which is really awesome. But headlined by really good stuff. Of course, last month with Amazing Red and Sanjay Dutt was a tremendous match, and then upped again by adding Jason Gorey to the mix. Remy's pag tag team partner were shown in the last segment a little bit.
Hey, I mean,
those three just tore the house down. It was amazing. I enjoyed watching it like I expected to. I mean, I wasn't disappointed or anything.
I was gonna agree. I didn't actually see the match, but just based on those names, awesome guys, awesome performers. I would love to see that match. I'm sure it was awesome. And Gorey is one of the guys that really helped me out when I was first kind of coming around and kind of took me under his wing. And I gotta give a lot of thanks to him and my boy Facade for kind of taking me under their wing. And Gorey is the man. And I would love to see that match. Sanjay is cool as hell too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, really cool guys.
Yeah.
But other than that, like really, really fun night. We were showing a little bit last show of Chris Taylor celebrating with a pizza and Count Chocolate awesome with his man. Heavyweight
love
title.
Chris.
Yes. Yes. It's one of those. It's great to see how your champion is represented by the food he eats or foods that he continues of adding Count Chocula. I was like, I want some of that. And the pizza looked good. I don't know if it came from Slice on Broadway, but that's all right. That's all right. We'll forgive him this time.
That's right.
So, I mean, it was a great night. The crowd was into everything from match one all the way to match nine. It was amazing.
Yes, matches. Holy crap, nine matches.
Yes, folks. And one of those matches had a caveman in it. I enjoyed the caveman.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun with
Was it Mr. Fetty?
Mr. Fetty?
Was it the Beastman?
I don't know. No. Oh, he was just listed as the caveman. Oh, you're talking about Super Beast.
No.
He's more of a caveman. Okay. And by the way, here's a shot for you guys on video of that championship celebration picture.
I mean, that's what I'm doing if I'm winning any strap.
Some Knob Creek in a Hydra cup, pizza and Count Chocolate, and the belt sitting there, just hanging out.
I can't take pictures of my good times. It'd be
bad. That's not safe for the Facebook, right? But no,
K5 that.
Yeah, there you go. But no, as we were saying, this was an impromptu. Like, these are just some extra guys that were around, right? And
from what I heard, these are amazing Red students.
There you go. So, that amazing Red is training cavemen. I don't know.
I guess he is pretty amazing when you can train a caveman to wrestle.
But it was a fun match. I couldn't contain this by just playing on the DVD or digital download. So we tossed that up there. The entire match is up on YouTube, up on the Facebook for RWA.
Oh, wow.
And I hope you guys check it out and get a little bit out of it. And one extra thing, and I don't know, talking a little bit to production, I guess.
Did you see senior official Tommy Trueblood there?
Yes, there is. Tommy Trueblood, yeah.
I do love Tommy. Tommy's is a great guy.
But he was Iron Manning at last. That he did all but one of the nine matches.
Takes a great ref bump.
Yes, does he?
Yeah, he does.
But no, it was a good time. And the other thing we tried to do, and I want to see how people are receptive to it. That building, court time. I feel like sometimes the building's too big, so it doesn't contain the crowd noise as well, and it kind of dissipates in that large space. But this is, of course, it's a crappy little gymnasium. Let's be honest here when it comes to RWA. And the crowd is very rabid and into it, and was for nine matches. Like, I don't remember them dying for a match throughout the night. And I mean, that is a long haul, right? And RWA feels like it's kind of story intensive. And so I went and grabbed like kind of the entrances to several of the matches, like pretty much like beginning through first bell in most cases. And sometimes there are promos and some starts of matches. But I wanted to get the crowd reactions. I feel like that's not being conveyed enough. And I'm hoping that kind of helps people kind of get the vibe of what's happening here. Like, it feels like there's something cool happening here that it's all the locals coming. I really don't think the audience crosses over with an IWC, PWX, VOW that much for the most part.
Right.
And I'm hoping that really kind of comes out here. But no, really good show there. A lot of fun matches. Even the six-man tag was good. Memfo Mofo, another guy that impresses me every show. And check him out. He's got this Mofo show thing going on. Online.
It's amazing. Sorg and I are in love with this stuff because I think we both look forward to, even if it's not RWA, if he does one, we got to watch it just to see what he does, because the man is entertainment. And he does this just himself, I think. I'm not sure if he has anybody
else. He does, because I think I tweeted, I was like, you got to do more of those. And he's like, man, those take a long time to do. I was like, yeah, but they stick out. You know, I mean, it's more than just putting a phone right here and shooting a promo in your face. It's. I mean, look at like when Johnny Gargano did the show back in the day, right? I think that got him a lot of traction. Anybody doing very interesting things like that? Even like, look at Claudio did the coffee thing for a while. Was that Ryder with that whole thing too? I mean, it sticks out. It's
Zane and Caleb
visual.
Take over the world. You have the those high spots guys, Zane exactly. Ryder, Caleb Connolly, exactly. And I think that's important too. I mean, this is kind of a side note, but Workaholics, the TV show, I mean, they're huge wrestling fans. Mm-hmm. And I feel like if we can bring more current, I think, and, I don't know if Vince is out of touch, whatever. But I think that there's always that feeling that wrestling is, that I'm saying the people on the outside looking in view wrestling as very just hillbilly, dumbed down, stupid, you know, bad, just 90s comedy recycled. And I think that, you know, there, yeah, of course there's some of that out there, but the more creative, yeah, this is awesome. The more creative stuff you can do and the more you put into it, you know, you get what you put into it. And I'm all about this DIY, learn how to film it yourself, learn how to set up the camera yourself, edit yourself. And you're learning how to do a bunch of stuff all at once. And at the end, you have something that's adding to wrestling. It's making it, it's different. It's inspiring, you know, it's creative, and that's what it's all about. You can't, it's not just go to the gym and show up and get in the ring. That's important. But that's not what attracts me to it. The creative side is what attracts me to it, and stories, right, and characters. And,
right.
And I like that you can kind of, everyone's kind of looking to be the first to do something, especially in wrestling. And that's kind of a fun challenge because it seems like everything's been done. It's just like being in a, making music, you know?
I didn't realize that this, he made At Midnight.
What do you do?
Basically,
he,
yeah.
He made At Midnight. Like they just, oh, wow. He just like showed some video of his tweet popping up on At Midnight. Hold on, let's see if pull it up. Yeah, he completely made At Midnight. It's like late tanning, hashtag Jersey a book. That's amazing.
See? So he, obviously he's doing something right.
Aaron.
Oh no, we got Wheelz and Wi-Fi slow-mo. Oh no. The Mofo Show is overtaking our bandwidth, I think. But but no, really good show.
Or we're having a stroke.
I think we're all having a collective stroke. But no, RWA Bloody Harvest, worth checking out. We have individual matches over on IndieWrestling.us. So just pay $1, $2, whatever the case may be. You can check out, you know, even that three-way match with Gory Dutton, Amazing Red. Great stuff. Can't wait to see what they pull out. Some great names coming through there as well, making some noise. So. And the next show is Open Season, and yes, and that's coming up. We'll be talking about that leading the
November
as well.
7th. Yep.
I'd be remiss if I did not mention, because one Chris LaRusso, you bypassed him on the way in here, Remy.
I did.
Yes, and he is going to be involved in Remix Pro Wrestling's Homeward Bound. Wait. That's not the Throwdown for the Pound 12. It's going to have a lot of names on there.
Wow, look at this.
Look at all that. Of course, Facade is going to be teaming with Matt Hardy in a match. Candice LeRae.
Remix always stands out to me. Their graphics are awesome. It seems they have a very nice product.
Eric Young is going to be there.
Got Gory.
I see Bulldozer in there somewhere.
Sweating really hard.
And a lot of cool stuff going on there. Check it out. And of course, if you can't make it to Marietta, Ohio, Gory's going to be part of it as well. If you can't make it out to Marietta, Ohio, please check out remixprowrestling.com. After this week, they're going to have, I understand, Blu-ray and DVD they've been doing.
Oh, Blu-ray.
So you can
wow.
pick up any of those. I don't know if they have digital download options, perhaps, but go check them out. So with that, Eamon, I know we have Around the Indies with Matt Carlins. You've touched base with that. What's fit to talk about in the Indies? He does such a great job of that article over there.
Definitely. Well, I would encourage anyone to check out the article over at IndieWrestling.us. Like Sorg mentioned, the great rundown of everything that happened this week. I guess the big thing that kind of stuck out from this week was all the stuff that happened actually in one place in Berwyn, Illinois. First for AAW, which was their event on Friday. Tons of great independent wrestling talent. AAW, one of the premier promotions in the Midwest, obviously, delivering some really cool stuff. But then also the next two nights was the Shimmer 10th anniversary tapings. They take four events, basically. Their Shimmer tapings. A lot of big stuff coming from there. Obviously, we have a new Shimmer champion in Madison Eagles, who defeated former champion Nicole Matthews in a no DQ match. So she is now a two-time Shimmer champion. Also, a bit of her sadder news from that came the announcement that Portia Perez was retiring that weekend due to a number of different injuries. Yeah, definitely. I actually had the privilege of working with Portia once for wrestling, and it was a really great honor. She's a very talented professional wrestler, and it's unfortunate that she had to depart from the wrestling world
Didn't we both see her for the first time up at Prime Wrestling that one time we both went?
That's true. Yeah, she did. Yeah, I think that was the first time I had seen her like live compete. You know, just even getting to work with her, she's extremely talented, and you know, she is, I think, definitely going to be missed. The third thing that I guess kind of came out from that was her retirement match was on the main event of the final taping of Shimmer. It was a 4-on-4 tag team match, which saw the return of two familiar faces to Shimmer wrestling. I don't know if permanently or just for this one-time occasion, but Lacey, who some may know from Ring of Honor fame and her very well-known feud with Jimmy Jacobs and the stuff that occurred there, made her in-ring wrestling return after, I want to say, like 6 or 7 years to be a part of this match. And also on the opposing side, they saw a return in a well-known indie wrestling female, Daisy Hayes, who returned to the wrestling ring, which was very cool to see. Definitely two people that, obviously, all this talk about great women's wrestling that's been happening nowadays in the wrestling world, these two were definitely very much pioneers. Those two, Lacey and Daisy Hayes, were the first ever Shimmer main event. So, yeah, I mean, very cool to see. So it looked like a really great weekend in Berwyn, Illinois, all around.
Awesome. Awesome. And go subscribe to that. Check that out and everything else going on, indywrestling.us. What's going on in Inspire World, Eamon?
Oh, we actually have a lot. There's been a good, like, period of break or time or whatever between our next event, which will be November 1st. And that's our Tagcade event, which will crown our first ever Inspire Pro Tag Team Champions in a big one-night tournament. Yeah, that will be really fun. Tickets are on sale for that at inspireprowrestling.com. Immediate, like the next weekend after that, we're doing Fun Fest all 3 nights, the 6th, 7th, and 8th. So that will be crazy and really, really fun. And yeah, there's cool stuff coming down the pipeline for 2016. And yeah, it should be really fun going forward.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, I think that's all the indie that we have worthwhile. Holy crap. It's been a long one tonight. Thank you so much, sorry. Remy Lavey, talking our ears off tonight.
I just want to say thanks to you guys. You know, like, I think I truly think this stuff is awesome. I watch all this. I'm not ashamed. I will always be a fan. I'll always be a mark. And I think it's important to support the things that support you and support the wrestlers. And it's all important. It's all what makes independent wrestling specifically so awesome. And thank you guys for having me on. And definitely everyone out there, keep supporting the show. And keep supporting independent wrestling. That's what it's all about.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Also, speaking of indie wrestling, at Hot Wheels RWA, check out their stuff, rwalive.com. At Eamon 2, please, inspireprowrestling.com. And a lot of fun stuff going over there. And, of course, check out iwcwrestling.com. I will be there as well, here with Remy, for IWC's Unbreakable. Headline is going to be Rhino, Jimmy Nuts, and John McChesney. For IWC Heavyweight Title, other great names.
I am excited to just watch the show. It's going to be a great show. If you're in the Pittsburgh area, if you're in the Elizabeth area, and you got nothing going on Saturday, or even if you have plans, cancel your plans.
Get out of here. Just cancel. Just come on down.
Come on down.
It's going to be a good show. It's I think it's arguably it's the biggest show in the area.
Support some independent wrestling this weekend, why don't you?
That's right. That's right. Exactly. Why don't you? So thank you, everybody. Check it out, WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Drop us a line if you got anything to say. Good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, 412-206-WMS0. We'll see you guys next time, and please support indie wrestling. Show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.
Hi, everyone. Do you like video games? Do you like reading about video games? Do you like listening to podcasts about video games? Why don't you check out InsertCoinToBegin.com? New articles going up daily, and you can check out our podcast, Boss Battle, on SorgatronMedia.com.